Securiy is an information security company in Ann Arbor, Michigan. We specialize in a thing called two-factor authentication, which verifies a user's identity through something they know, like their password, and something they have, like their phone.
One of the drawbacks of the previous generation of multi-factor authentication solutions out there is that it's inherently phishable. With Duo Push, the push comes directly onto your phone, and you are able to identify where the request is coming, by whom, and for what.
We were all going to be heading to DEF CON, the big hacker conference in Las Vegas, and we thought it'd be great to do some kind of stunt there. And being the sort of tech, sci-fi, space geeks that we all are, someone just sort of threw out there, we should do a push authentication from space. And everyone got real quiet for a second after a couple chuckles, and then we were like, actually, we could do that.
We're going to attempt to send a push two-factor authentication request from the boundary of space. I had a general idea of what needed to happen to make this launch a success. In general, you need only a few things. You need a giant latex balloon, a crap load of helium, and something to send up. The primary payload is an iridium sat phone that is hooked up to a Raspberry Pi. On the Raspberry Pi, we'll be looking to see when an actual Duo push comes in. And when that does, we'll actuate a finger to come and push the accept button on the phone. We needed a place to actually launch the balloon from, so we settled for this little town called Nipton, California.
And I mean, if we run another 100 simulations, there's gonna be another 20 dots over dead mountains.
Yep. The plan is the plan.
Everything worked at the test launch. You know, the recovery of the balloon and the payload went well. We got a lot of good footage, but some things did not go to plan. Communications with the satellite phone did not work. The other thing that didn't work was some of the cameras actually crapped out.
There's 3 hours, 24 minutes available.
That's the card,
3 hours, 54 minutes. This one got... It has 3 hours, 20 minutes remaining.
So we never even actually got to see the ultimate height from the cameras that were on the payload. They died about halfway up.
Based off of what we learned in version one, there's still a lot that has changed and that could still go wrong. So for instance, like the payload body itself has a significantly larger internal volume. So that means the electronics inside are more spread apart.
You know, we decided at a certain point, it's like this should feel like a lunar landing module. This should feel like at least be styled in a way that seemed like something NASA might do.
I think the structure is really, really sound, and the shell that's around it will absorb a lot of it. And those feet that are on there, if it lands feet first, that will take a lot of the blow, and hopefully it's the bottom that'll get destroyed, not necessarily the side of the top. I'm worried a little bit about the boom, but I think it'll be okay.
Coming to DEF CON and bringing this here, it's definitely been quite the experience, because this is quite ridiculous.
Everyone who we told about it, you know, at first they're like, why are you doing this? And then we talk a bit more about it and they're like, wait, you're doing what? And it really just kind of captured a lot of people's attention there. And it was really cool to be able to do it during a convention that so many people are in the same place. People were coming up to our table that we had there where we were promoting the thing, and you know, they started out skeptical and they ended up inspired, and that's really what we're going for.
Like we're gonna hit 30 kilometers up, flight time of right around 2 hours. Things are looking good. The landing sites look fairly favorable in terms of us being able to actually get to them directly.
similar.
Looks very similar. I don't think the weather forecast has changed at all. We're still looking like we're gonna hit this valley, which is good, which means we're gonna miss the Gene Airport.
Yeah.
And the women's prison.
Oh. I'm gonna put $50 on salt flats.
Is it near the salt flats?
Or the dried lake bed, it looks like, yeah. We will actually prove for some of you out there that the world is actually round. So that's
or at least the GoPro lenses.
Yes, or at least the GoPro lenses sure. Round.
We went out there with like a field army of cameras and people to film that stuff, as well as another half dozen people just to help with the balloon. I mean, once you start filling that balloon, somebody's got to be holding on to that the whole time. And when I was holding it like so many times, I just pictured myself like, oops. And this thing just away from us. And then the whole thing, and all of that would have been live streamed. So that would have been extra embarrassing.
We're also going to be using these strings to attach the payload and the parachute. And
yeah.
You and everything else to the balloon that's going to go off to space.
Of course.
Are the GoPros all running?
Yep, GoPros are good to go, according to Rick.
As soon as it started going up, there was some initial spin from the tangling of the line a little bit, because we gave a lot more lead for the balloon itself from the top of the parachute itself, because I wanted to not obscure the sat phone antenna as much as possible. So as it goes up, the air is going down over it, and that caused additional spin up until the solar panel ended up turning a full 90 degrees and becoming horizontal, at which point it stopped affecting and started creating more drag again.
So we left Nipton, and we had a general idea of where it was going to go based on simulations that we were able to do. So we had a rough idea that it was going to go north, you know, heading back towards Vegas.
We're at 51,000 feet, Pete, 51,000.
Let's go get it.
So logged in, now gonna try to call the payload. We are waiting for the phone to actually receive the duo push request, actuate the finger, hit the accept button, and then talk back with duo services on the ground, all through this really, really tiny, tiny, very, very laggy, very, very lossy and unreliable pipe right now.
Come on, welcome, Professor. At that point, we knew that the push hadn't worked.
We literally just could not maintain enough connectivity to be able to get the request there.
Okay, yeah. I guess it's falling too fast at this point. So we gotta switch over to recovery ops. We gotta get into radio range so where we can pick it up, because we're not gonna figure it, we're not gonna be there.
Wrap it up.
It's gonna be a little shaky.
Yep.
So we were able to get about a mile and a half from where we last saw it. End up, and then we just geared up, got a bunch of water, and headed out into the desert.
It landed sideways.
Darn it. Oh, look, the solar panel's moving.
Had beefed up our audio beacon this time, and we heard it from a good bit away, which was great, because then we found it immediately.
Damn, look at the boom. Ooh. Ooh.
The cameras are still on?
Oh, we lost
That's a satellite antenna.
The next thing that we need to do was check the cameras. This was the critical moment. Like, did we get the footage that we wanted? And we had some really, really mixed results.
Some of us are like just extremely excited to find it. Some of us are immediately going into what's on the cameras. I gotta see if this worked. What went wrong? What went right? Like, I wasn't quite ready to celebrate just finding the thing because we had done that before. I wanted to see what was on these cameras. Like, you know, we weren't done yet.
This one is on, but the time code is like frozen or something. The biggest letdown was the means of stabilizing the payload ended up failing very, very quickly and actually ended up hindering us in the long run by making the spin worse in the ascent rate.
So we get back to the hotel, we dump it all on the computers and we start watching it on the screen, and we already knew that two of the GoPros had not lasted the entire trip. So I was worried about, you know, the third one. If two of them went bad, and the third one shown it caught footage, did it really? Like, did it actually? Because the other two had 9 minutes of footage. And we had one that had 2 hours. And it's like, you know, we're all just pulling for this one camera to have held out the entire time. And so we check out the short ones first. You know, there was some pretty excessive spin on the payload. So some of those, even those short camera angles were a little tough to watch. But then we pulled up the shot from the boom arm, scrubbed right to the part where we get to 100,000 feet, and it was just like, boom. This is the shot we wanted. Like, all the stuff not working just went away when we saw the curve of the Earth, the blackness of space above it, and we saw this thing that we had built up there, you know, with the stickers on it that we had put on there, like logos that we had made, the whole damn thing that we had just assembled that morning. There's stars above it, there's ground below, and we got that shot.
Watching that footage was amazing. I was just absolutely elated to see so much detail there. We could see it, like all the cables slack, and it started its descent back down. First, it was very, very smooth, just coming down, kind of pitching a little bit before there was enough air to actually catch the parachute itself. And then it started turning into this crazy double pendulum, which I had never expected to occur. So we had the payload at certain points above the balloon itself, looking down. It was quite insane.
You know, the security industry treads a lot on fear and despair, and you should buy our stuff because you're gonna get taken down by hackers. We wanna be on the inspiring side. We're all kind of in this together. Let's do something together. Let's build something and put it in the space.
I kept getting messages from people about the live stream as they were following along. I was completely blown away that we managed to maintain the live stream for that long.
A tendency to be extra snarky, you know, whether it actually worked or didn't, people would look at it and say, I wish I had done that too. Whether or not you thought it was a dumb idea, like, it was pretty fun to do.